guys, welcome back to London. Today we're doing Broadway Market. Hi guys, welcome back to London. I've come to London Field Station. It's right next to the station is this park at the end of the street called London Fields. On the other side of the park is a road called Broadway Market, named after the market that's held there every Saturday. Saturday today, just want to check out the market, I want to get some coffee and something to eat. So let's head on over there, walk through the park. It's not a particularly nice day here in London though. The park here, London Fields, is very popular in fine weather, but today it's not one of those days. So let's head to the market.
London Fields has been on maps here in London for centuries. This was once the rural outskirts of London, and this was common land. It was used to graze sheep by drivers of livestock into the livestock markets in town. And a lot of the surrounding streets are named after mutton. There's the Cat and Mutton Pub, Sheep Road, Lamb Lane, that sort of thing. And it often gets attributed to the fact that this was grazing land, but this was actually once called Shoulder of Mutton Park, but simply because it looks like a shoulder of mutton, the cut of meat on a map. And the history of that seems to get a little bit muddled, but yeah, there's a lot of sheep and mutton references simply because of the shape of the park on a map.
Okay, welcome to Broadway Market, the street, and as it's a Saturday and market day, Broadway Market, the market.
There's been a market here since at least 1835. The street was originally called Duncan Place. It was renamed Broadway in 1881. Because of the success of the market in 1937, it was renamed Broadway Market. It fell into steady decline after the Second World War, and that was probably compounded by the rise of the supermarket. It nearly disappeared in the late 1990s.
First up, gonna get some coffee here. Clemson and Sons.
I was going to get a pour over style coffee, but for one reason or another they're not up to that right now, so it's espresso based drinks only for now. So I'm going to order a black Americano. The cakes look pretty good too.
Black Americano from Clemson and Son Coffee. They've actually, they've got a roasters just where we started from actually, by in the railway arches by London Fields station, Clemson's Arch, where they roast coffee. They've got a brew bar there as well, I think. Let's try the, I've got an espresso. Black Americano. Good coffee. Right, let's take a look at the market stalls. Find it's pretty busy. Find something to eat. We're headed right to the other end by the Regent Canal.
It's hard to believe looking at it today, but by the late 1990s, Broadway Market had pretty much ceased to exist. It had been going since the 1830s. By the late 1990s, you've got one or two stalls turning out on a Saturday. A number of the shops were boarded up and dilapidated, with very few visitors. But in a story that kind of played out, not just here, but across much of London, in the late 1990s and at the start of this century, land values and property values started to grow exponentially. And that created probably unprecedented private development. People were buying and converting anything they could into residential property, and that was, yeah, it was feeding itself. So in around 2004-2005, new organisers step in and start the market that we know today. I guess back then it would have been called a farmer's market, and yeah, it's been hugely successful, but it wasn't without, and still isn't without, opposition. It was seen, I guess, as one of the causes of the regeneration, which people negatively label as gentrification. And although it wasn't the spark that caused it, it's possibly added fuel to that fire in a very visible way. And people object to that, always have and always will. But yeah, it's definitely the busiest it's probably been ever. There's probably never been this many market stalls in this market since 1830, and it's probably more prosperous than it's ever been. It seems everywhere I go, the topic of regeneration or gentrification, depending on whether you want to see it in a positive or negative way, the topic comes up time and time again here in London. And I'd say from an outsider's point of view, it's easy to see that change can be challenging, but every time it's almost impossible to overlook the opportunities that the regeneration brings. Unless, of course, you want to buy or rent property privately. And then, of course, it's a huge obstacle. But then, I guess, there's a huge flip side to that, and that is for the people selling and letting property privately. And they're often always talking a good game about how the gentrification has negative impacts, but I never see them reducing the asking prices for their selling or lettings. Okay, all the food looks and smells incredible at the market, but today for lunch I'm going to go for one of London, certainly East London's most traditional dishes, from F. Cook Pie Mash and Eel Shop. It's believed the first pie and mash shops opened in London in around the 1850s, 1860s, maybe earlier. Simultaneously, the first fish and chip shops were opening, and it's not the invention of either dish. Pies had been eaten for much, much longer. Same as fish and chips, it wasn't the invention of the dishes, it was really the development of, I guess, what we would call today the takeaway, working class, inexpensive restaurants. And that was really because London was sprawling outwards, filled with the working classes, and it was industrialised, and it was cheap, filling food.
Okay. Pie, one pie, one mash, hot eels, side of hot eels.
The green sauce is called liquor. Traditionally, it's a sort of fish stock. It's the liquid the eels are stewed in, mixed with parsley, which is why it's bright green. The eel meat just falls off the bone. You can see there's still sawdust. They keep sawdust on the floor. Traditionally, you would have slung the eel bones on the floor, and it made it easier to clean up and a little bit less slippery. This store's been open since 1900. It was opened by Mr. Cook, and this chap here is the current Mr. Cook, the grandson of the founder of the business. They do jelly deals as well as the hot eels, which is another traditional London dish. So yeah, if you're in Broadway Market, definitely pop in, you can eat in. And they do pie and mash and the eels to go as well.
Yeah.
Okay, that was F. Cook Pie and Mash Pioneer shop. They're doing a bit of work on the exterior of the shop. You can see a scaffolding, but normally it looks a lot more picturesque than that. But yeah, if you come here, definitely come to Broadway Market, definitely check out F. Cook's store. While I'm sitting there eating, you get a whole sort of flux of tourists coming in and asking about the history, because he's been there, opened in 1900 by the chap behind the counter today's grandfather, largely unchanged. So a lot of people interested in the history, but you should definitely pop in and try the food. The pie is good, the mash is good, with eels, the original surf and turf, and it's actually lighter than you would imagine. It's not as heavy as it looks. Delicious mince pies. F. Cook, check it out. Right, let's go and check out the market. As well as the street market on Broadway Market itself, in the schoolyard here there's another quite big Saturday market, same sort of mix, a bit of food, slightly more arts and crafts stalls in there, just opposite the park, London Fields there, right at the end of Broadway Market. Right, before I head off, I want to go and get a quick drink, pint in one of the pubs here. There's this pub, the Cat and Mutton, right on the edge of London Fields Park there. So yeah, let's go and grab a let's go and get a quick drink.
Israel, listen.
Drink outside. It's the most hipster pub I think I've ever been in. I think one guy had quite a full beard down to here. I think his skin tone that can only be achieved by a fake tan. Fake tan and a beard.
You're going to be surprised when they're on my
game. Really? You're like
funky. Good looking pub. Funny crowd. Good choice of drinks and beer though. A lot of those drinks would be guess Bloody Marys. Celery sticks hanging out of a big glass. Borderline a little cocktail umbrellas. Very pretentious pub. Nothing wrong with the booze though. Okay guys, thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this trip to Broadway Market. I'm going to take a walk back through London Fields to the station and head off. Coffee at Climpson's was good, and the trip to F. Cook's pie and mash shop, traditional pie, East London dish of pie mash and eels, that was good, and a quick pint in the Cat and Mutton pub. I'd say that's definitely, a lot of the time when you read about Broadway Market or the read about it or watch videos about it, there's people often complaining about being a cause of gentrification. It's really a symptom of gentrification that happened decades ago here in Hackney. And they're often complaining about it, but most of those, I've been here quite a few times in the past, and most of those were really focused on the price of the goods on sale. I think a lot of people, there's a lot of social housing, there's a lot of private housing, but there's a lot of traditional social housing surrounding the area, and I guess people felt excluded primarily based on price, the price of the things, I would guess. But now the crowd there, that's the biggest concentration of middle class hipsters I've seen for a long, long time. That's the new hipster high street for sure. But it's definitely worth a trip just to people watch, try the amazing street food, the stores, the boutiques. Definitely come and check out Broadway Market if you're in town. Saturday market. So thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed it. I'm gonna head back to the station. So toodles. in these videos, I'm always moaning about the hipsters, but the reality is I'd rather be in a herd of them than the kind of people they replaced. They dress like they've got no money, but the reality is, I mean, I grew up, I've lived in London all my life, the kind of people they replaced, I guess, the gangs they replaced, they're a bunch of relative pussies compared to the people that would have grown up on most of the surrounding estates here. And they dress like they've got no money, but compared to the people I grew up with, gangs of kids with no money, yeah, they're unpredictable and dangerous. They're not. Right, let's go.